All right, my name is Sam Estreicher. I teach at NYU School of Law. I've been here for quite a long time, very hard to believe. One employer and one wife during this entire period of time, and still in love with my wife. Now, we believe here that the annual conference on labor is the premier conference in the country for putting together labor management practitioners, lawyers, and HR people. And we've been organized around a theme since 1991, so each conference is organized around a theme. And we produce the papers in the form of a conference volume. And our publisher is LexisNexis, so we're very happy with that association. It's a LexisNexis table at the back, and I'm pretty sure they'll give you a conference discount for the conference volumes. Now, today's theme is, it's as if, by the way, we're in the age of Aquarius. This is the second age of Aquarius. The first age of Aquarius was in the 60s, when all the planets were in alignment, and we were young, and our bodies worked. Now we're in the second age of Aquarius. The planets are still in alignment, but they're aligned in the service of a different set of issues. And the issues turn on the employment relationship and how to define the employment relationship. And that's our theme here. Who is an employee and who is the employer? And issues regarding these questions are popping up all the time under the Fair Labor Standards Act, under virtually all of the statutes. And I guess they've always been hot issues, but there have been significant changes in the nature of the employment relationship. We're going to look at that. And we're also going to look at changes in the nature of labor organizations. So I think you're going to find this a very rich program. It's a very compacted program. We're going to be doing everything on time. Because the one thing I learned from an old socialist, Mussolini, he was, by the way, the head of the Italian Socialist Party. But the one enduring lesson we learned from the Mussolini years is that if you run the trains on time, you can get away with murder. Now, I'm not speaking literally, but there's a similar idea there. So it may well be that many of you will not get your questions in. And if that's the case, send me an email, and we'll get the questions answered one way or another. My email address is samuel.estreicher. Estreicher at nyu.edu. Now, I have a very easy job because I have brought talent to the program. I have talent introducing the speakers. I have talent moderating the sessions. And I have brought talent in the presence of all of you. So there's almost nothing for me to do but sit back and learn. And our first speaker will be introduced by the very able Jim Paulson, who's the regional director of Region 29. I know lots of board lawyers here. Board's a great agency, and the regional director position is very important, and it's so ably filled by Jim and by our other regional director here in the area, who will also be involved a little later on. So I'm going to turn it over to Jim Paulson.
Great. Well, I'm really glad to be here today and also to have the honor of introducing to you Richard F. Griffin, Jr. He was sworn in as General Counsel of the National Labor Relations Board on November 4th, 2013, for a four-year term. Prior to becoming General Counsel, Mr. Griffin served as a board member from January 9th, 2012, through August 2nd, 2013. Previously, he served as general counsel for the International Union of Operating Engineers. He also served on the board of directors for the AFL-CIO Lawyers Coordinating Committee, a position he held since 1994. Since 1983, he was in a number of leadership positions with the IUOE, from assistant house counsel to associate general counsel. And from 1985 to 1994, he served as a member of the Board of Trustees of IUOE's Central Pension Fund. Prior to taking the job with the union, he was from 1981 to 1983 serving as a counsel to NLRB board members. So he was one of the alumni of the board even before he came back to the board. So he holds his BA degree from Yale University and a JD degree from Northeastern University School of Law. I take great pleasure in introducing him because working for him, he is working very hard to make the agency very relevant, very vital, and very effective. He continues the important 10J initiatives. He's working on initiatives of how we handle issues involving employees whose immigrant status may be in question. He's worked with all the regional offices in implementing the board's new R case rules. So without further ado, I introduce to you Richard F. Griffin.
Thank you very much, Jim and Sam. I want to start by acknowledging, because we do have quite a few people who work in the both headquarters office of the board and in the regional offices, I want to start by acknowledging the great work that they do for the agency on a daily basis. Jim and Karen Fernbach, and I'm told, although I haven't seen them yet, that Dave Leach, who's the regional director, Region 22, will also be here, are really the people who do the primary work of the agency. And I have a series of statistics that I use to demonstrate this, which is last fiscal year, the board received 20,415 unfair labor practice charges. Of those charges, about 35% were determined to be meritorious, about 65% were determined to be without merit and either withdrawn or dismissed. Of the charges that were determined to be with merit, 93.4% of them were settled without any litigation. So all that work that I just described is essentially done in the regional offices with very little, if any, input from headquarters, and that's the real work of the agency. That's the public face of the agency. That's who people see on a daily basis. So I want to thank the people here from Region 2 and Region 29 and Region 22 for the work that they do. Secondly, I have kind of a bone to pick with this venue. I walked over here this morning and I was a little chilly. And those of you who know anything about me know that I'm originally from Buffalo, New York, and it has been my experience that people from the New York City greater metropolitan area take great sport in mentioning the weather in Buffalo. Now, I happened to be in Buffalo a month ago. That is 1 month prior to today, at a conference that was co-sponsored by the Cornell ILR School and Region 3 in the New York State Bar Labor Section on the occasion of the 80th anniversary of the National Labor Relations Act. And I just want to let you New Yorkers know that on that day, at the beginning of May, it was 91 degrees in Buffalo.
Even a dead clock gets it right twice a day.
So I just mentioned that. So I have a number of things that I'd like to talk about that have been happening recently and that you may be interested in. These include the rollout of the new representation election rule, the General Counsel's guidance memorandum on employer handbook rules, the guidance memo on remedies in situations involving undocumented workers, and a couple of other things. And I hope when we have time for questions, if you're interested in those things, that you will take this occasion to raise whatever questions about those you have. But my assignment and what I'm going to focus on is a topic that has been, as Sam mentioned, of great interest, and that is the joint employer issue. And I'm also going to, at the end, make some short remarks about an independent contractor case and about some cases involving airline contractors where there's a jurisdictional issue between the National Labor Relations Board and the National Mediation Board. But I'm going to focus primarily on the joint employer issue. And I'm going to start by just discussing briefly what is the position of the General Counsel's Office in the Browning-Ferris case. because that is a case where the board asked for briefing on whether or not it should modify its current joint employer standard, and if so, what the new standard should be. And it did so in a case that is sort of a classic contingent workforce case where Browning Ferris has a group of people who are, without question, Browning Ferris employees who are organized and in a bargaining unit, and there's a collective bargaining relationship. There are then a number of other people who work at the Browning Ferris location who have been working at the Browning Ferris location for a fairly extended period of time, but who are provided by another company. And the issue in Browning Ferris is whether the other company is the employer or whether, in addition to the other company, Browning Ferris is a joint employer. And the board asked for briefing on that subject. And this is a representation case because there has been a petition filed seeking to represent that group that is currently unrepresented. Now, the General Counsel's office did file an amicus brief in the case, and many other people, entities, filed amicus briefs. And you will hear later, I think, from some of them. And there were a number of very good briefs filed in that case, and I would, if you want to read them, and I would suggest that it's worth looking at them, you can do so by going on to the board's website and looking to the Browning Ferris case page, and all the briefs are there, and you can just click and read them. And so there are a number of very powerful briefs that took the position that if it ain't broke, don't fix it, that the current standard, the standard that those folks would say is defined in the TLI and Laerco cases, cases that were decided in 1984, which says that the board will find a joint employer if the putative joint employer has immediate and direct impact on substantial terms and conditions of employment, that standard should continue to apply. There are other briefs that were filed, most notably by the EEOC, arguing that the board law should be modified to get in line with what the EEOC represents is the standard applied in a number of other employment law contexts, which is a somewhat a less stringent standard. And so in that context, the General Counsel's office filed an amicus brief and asked the board or suggested to the board that what it ought to do is return to what we characterized as the traditional joint employer standard, a standard which we cite to a series of cases starting in the late 30s and going on up through the early 80s, was the standard that previously applied before these cases, TLI and Laerco. And that standard would look to not just direct but also indirect impacts on employment. It would look to both actual and potential impacts on employment. It would be a multi-factor test, and it would depend on the facts and circumstances, as pretty much every joint employer case turns anyway on the particular facts and circumstances. So why did we suggest that the board should change the standard? Why now? Why in this case? First of all, they asked us. But secondly, we think that it's important to acknowledge the changing nature of the workplace. And there's a lot of documentation on this. It's in the nature of businesses' move to focus on core competencies. It's in the nature of the dynamism of the capitalist system that business structures will change. And it is the board's job as the expert agency designated by Congress to deal with sort of industrial realities as they develop, to modify the law to take into account the changing nature of the workplace. And in the in our brief, we focus really on two types of workplaces where we say there have been changes. The first is the type of workplace that is the Browning-Ferris workplace, where you have aspects of what used to be understood to be the employer-employee relationship divided up between more than one entity. So there you have the company that supplies the people, on whose payroll the people are, that determines their compensation and a number of other aspects of their situation. And then they get to the Browning-Ferris location, and Browning-Ferris tells them what work to do, supervises their immediate work, directs their work. So those aspects of the relationship are in two places. And this is increasingly common. We have all kinds of different companies that are in the payroll business that are taking on aspects of the employment relationship. And there's a trendy reference to this that the current administrator of the Wage and Hour Division of the Labor Department, David Weil, is credited with coining when he was a business professor at the Boston University Business School, which he calls it the fissured workplace. And that there are all these fissured aspects that result in multiple entities having one or another aspect of the employment relationship within their bailiwick.
He will be here tomorrow morning.
And he will be here tomorrow morning, and he is a very powerful speaker. I really think you'll be find his presentation fascinating. So the one example that we use of why it is that the joint employer relationship needs to take into account change, or the board's doctrine needs to take into account changes in the workplace, is the is this sort of contingent workforce situation. The other area that we cite, and this is the one that has very surprisingly to me caused a certain amount of controversy, is the franchisor-franchisee relationship. And in the brief, which again I would suggest if you get a chance that you might want to read the brief, when we address the franchisor-franchisee relationship, we acknowledge that there are a number of old cases, not very many, a couple, from the 60s and 70s era, where prior general counsels took the position that a franchisor and a franchisee were joint employers. And in those cases, the board came up with what appears to be a principle that can be summarized as, if what the putative joint employer, the franchisor, is doing is seeking to protect the uniformity of its brand or product, and as a result has a certain impact on terms and conditions of employment, that impact is insufficient to result in a joint employer relationship. And one of the cases, the one that's most frequently cited in this regard, is Love's Barbecue. And one of the aspects that is discussed is uniforms, so that if the franchisor requires everybody who works in the franchises to wear the same uniform, even though that's something that otherwise would be considered to be a mandatory term and condition of employment and something to be examined in this context, the board has said, well, that's insufficient. That type of impact is insufficient so long as it's going to the uniformity of the brand or product. And in the Browning-Ferris brief, the general counsel's position is that the board should not overturn that prior case law. But we say that there are some franchisors and some franchisees whose relationship is different than that, where the franchisor exerts more involvement in determining many aspects of the operation of the franchise, including has an important impact on determining terms and conditions of employment. And In those, and most of the reason for that, we posit, is that there are now something they didn't have back in the 60s and 70s, which are these very powerful computer programs where you can maintain real-time information across many locations, and the franchisor is able, utilizing those and others means, to have a much more active role in the operation of the franchise. And some franchisors take advantage of that opportunity and, in our view, go beyond protecting the uniformity of the brand or product in a way that should make them joint employers. So there is the change in the workplace. And then the question is, well, why is that relevant for our statute? And the reason is because the statute is supposed to encourage the practice and procedure of collective bargaining. And if you have parties who are not at the table who are otherwise necessary for effective collective bargaining, that presents a problem. So our view is that if there is this more involved relationship, and if in order to have effective collective bargaining, the other, the putative joint employer needs to be at the table, then the board should adopt a standard that takes into account those realities. So that is the Browning-Ferris brief. The Browning-Ferris case is still pending before the board. Subsequently, the general counsel's office had to deal with several hundred charges that were pending as a result of the Fast Food Workers National Campaign, the campaign that's characterized as the Fight for 15, and there are other ways of characterizing it, where there have been a number of particularly focused on certain fast food chains, including McDonald's. There have been actions, joint protected concerted activity engaged in by employees of those operations with labor organizations, community groups, and others as part of this national campaign. And there have been responses by employers to those, which include disciplining people, adopting rules and other things, resulting in unfair labor practice charges being filed. And with respect to McDonald's, several hundred unfair labor practice charges. Now, I'm very reluctant to discuss the McDonald's case in this room because a good portion of the trial team in McDonald's for the NLRB is here, and I'm sure that I'm going to say something that isn't, you know, particularly helpful from their standpoint, because as you can tell, I'm somewhat loose with my remarks. So I'm just going to point out that in the McDonald's, a couple things about McDonald's. The first is that these charges that were filed, a number of them alleged corporate McDonald's as a joint employer. And after reviewing them, a number of the charges were dismissed as not having merit. Some of the charges were settled. And in some of the charges, a merit determination was made. And based on the information that was provided both by McDonald's and in the course of the investigation of the charges, a determination was made that in those charges where merit was found and where it was alleged that the corporate franchisor was a joint employer, that we were going to proceed with a complaint that, in addition to naming the franchisee as the respondent, also named corporate McDonald's as a joint employer respondent. And so a number of complaints were issued. Some of those complaints were consolidated into a proceeding that has already begun here in Manhattan and will, if the plan ends up getting followed, move on to Chicago and ultimately to Los Angeles to try the complaint allegations with respect to the franchisors and corporate McDonald's that have come up in those various locations. And so far, the status is primarily motions. There was initially a motion that the general counsel had abused his discretion in consolidating the cases in this way, which the administrative law judge rejected. There were a number of motions to quash subpoenas. There is now essentially a schedule that's been established for producing information pursuant to the subpoenas, and I believe the trial is actually scheduled to commence in October. The final point about McDonald's that I want to make is that, and I have said this, had occasion to say this in response to, I think, four separate congressional oversight inquiries, and that is that the General Counsel's Office is proceeding in the McDonald's case under the current state of the law. That is, that we believe there are facts that will be demonstrated, that will be proven in this case, that will make out joint employer status for corporate McDonald's under the current state of the board's joint employer law. And that we are only arguing in the alternative that the same contention that we make in Browning Ferris, that the board ought to return to its traditional standard, should apply. So in order to find joint employer status in McDonald's, we believe there is no requirement for a change in board law. Now, as a result of the issuance of this complaint, and there has been a fair bit of concern in the franchisor-franchisee community that it is the position of the General Counsel's Office that every franchisor and every franchisee is a joint employer, regardless of the circumstances of the particular relationship. Now, as I pointed out, in the Browning Ferris brief, we explicitly said we were not seeking to overturn the prior board law, so that what that means is that if you have a situation where the franchisor and the franchisee are just in a relationship where the franchisor is trying to maintain the uniformity of the brand or product, that would be insufficient, pursuant to what we say in Browning Ferris, to make them joint employers. In addition, relatively recently, and I would commend this to anybody who's interested in this issue, there was an advice memorandum issued on April 28th in a case called Nutritionality Doing Business as Freshie. And this is involved a fast casual restaurant chain that has about 100 franchises worldwide and has a couple in Chicago. And in that case, in that advice memo, with very thorough review of a number of factors, the conclusion was that the franchisor, Freshie, was not a joint employer with the franchisee, Nutritionality, and either under the current board law or under the test that the General Counsel is asking the board to adopt in Browning Ferris. And the case is a pretty thorough review of the factors, but I think for those who are concerned that the McDonald's case represents a frontal attack on the franchisor-franchisee system, they should both read the Browning Ferris brief and read the Nutritionality advice memo, and perhaps they will receive some limited sense of relief. Those are my remarks with respect to the joint employer standard. On the independent contractor issue, which you're also going to be hearing about, the board's decision in FedEx Home Delivery is really the thing that is the focus, I think, of activity at the board. The board looked at its independent contractor standard in light of some D.C. Circuit cases that had argued that entrepreneurial opportunity, or not argued, but had seemed to indicate that entrepreneurial opportunity was kind of the animating principle you needed to look at in these cases, and reiterated that they had a multi-factor test. You looked at the restatement second factors, and that while entrepreneurial opportunity was something that you looked at, it was just one of a number of factors. The thing that is the big case in the independent contractor area for the general counsel's office was actually a case that was underway before FedEx Home Delivery, and it involved port drivers in the Port of Los Angeles. It's a Green Fleet Systems case, and there you had a very long-term effort by the Teamsters Union to organize port drivers who are employed by multiple entities in the Port of Los Angeles. Green Fleet was one of these companies. They had a number of people who were characterized as what are called company drivers, who were clearly on the payroll. Then they had lease drivers who they characterized as independent contractors. And it was our position that there wasn't a big difference really between the status of the lease drivers and the company drivers. In the response to an organizing campaign with respect to Green Fleet's employees and including the lease drivers, Green Fleet engaged in a whole panoply of unfair labor practices, including firing two lease contractors who argued to the state wage agency that they were actually employees and they were entitled to money and filed a state wage claim, and they were threatened for doing that and then ultimately fired because they didn't withdraw the state wage claim. So this was a 10J case, we sought with a little bit of trepidation because we were concerned about having the district court judge at a preliminary point in the litigation making this type of a determination on employee status versus independent contractor status. And because there was a very well-drafted agreement that each of these lease contractors or lease drivers had signed, where they seemed to acknowledge their status as independent contractors. And so you had a paper document that seemed to maybe make it difficult for us to make the demonstration. But nonetheless, given the egregious nature of the unfair labor practices, given the fact that these two folks were fired for engaging in what was clearly protected activity, we, Region 21, Olivia Garcia, the regional director there, felt strongly that we should proceed with a 10J, and we ultimately got authorization to do that and succeeded in getting a determination from the district court judge there that these lease drivers were in fact, or at least that there was reasonable basis for the regional director to contend in the complaint that they were employees, and therefore the judge issued a decision which directed, among a whole host of other things, the reinstatement of the two people who had been discharged. That case was a very high-profile case because the port drivers' organizing campaign in Los Angeles is a very high-profile matter. There have been a series of strikes. There has been active political involvement by the mayor of Los Angeles and others in trying to resolve the matter. And ultimately, it's my understanding that Green Fleet and the union have worked out some kind of an agreement. I think it's a car check neutrality type agreement. I'm not sure about all the details, but we did get the two lead people reinstated pursuant to the 10J injunction. The final thing that I want to discuss is something that has been an issue at the board for a long time, and that has to do with where the line is between National Mediation Board jurisdiction under the Railway Labor Act and NLRA or NLRB jurisdiction under the NLRA, where you're dealing with airline contractors. The Railway Labor Act covers both railroads and airlines, and for some reason, this question never comes up with respect to railroad contractors. I think the reason, and I don't know this for sure, and I would defer to anybody who's an expert in the area, but I think the reason it doesn't come up with respect to railroad contractors is because if you are covered by the Railway Labor Act and you are in the railroad business, you have to participate in the railroad retirement system, which is a very expensive proposition. So I think that the contractors do not want to be covered by the Railway Labor Act. Whereas in the airline industry, there's no similar equivalent fund or pension obligation. And there are quite a few aspects of the airline industry that have been contracted out over the years. And the issue has arisen as to whether or not those folks are covered by the which statute. And there is a tradition, or not just a tradition, there's actually doctrine at the board that if the question of jurisdiction is doubtful, that the NLRB will submit the matter to the National Mediation Board for an advisory opinion as to whether or not the NMB is taking jurisdiction. And to make a long story short, because I just got told I have 2 minutes to conclude my remarks, what ended up happening over time was, and the standard for referring it is if the jurisdiction is doubtful. But what ended up happening over time is that there became this practice of just kicking over to the NMB for an advisory opinion any case where the issue was raised by a party. And the NMB is a very small agency, and they have a considerable amount of work to do that's their own generated work, and they don't really need us to be continuously shipping over cases if we don't really need to be shipping over the case. And so when I became the general counsel, it turned out there were close to 20 cases pending over at the NMB, and this was quite an administrative burden for them. So what we ended up doing, and it was in conjunction working very closely with the NMB General Counsel, Mary Johnson, who was really very helpful in this regard, the NMB ended up issuing sort of a lead opinion on their airline contractors, which essentially laid out what circumstances they would take jurisdiction and said in that particular instance that they wouldn't, that it was the board's jurisdiction. And then we've asked the regions to do a much more thorough investigation to determine whether or not the jurisdictional issue is really doubtful. And what this has resulted in is us much less burdening the NMB with our advisory opinion requests, because typically what happens is there'll be a contract which may make the thing look like it should be under the NMB jurisdiction, but then the facts on the ground, once investigated, demonstrate that the contractor is sufficiently uncontrolled by the airline such that it should be National Labor Relations Act jurisdiction. So this has been a relatively successful interagency cooperative effort and has resulted in quite a few cases back at the board for resolution. And on that note, although I could talk about that at some length more, I'm going to stop.
Well, I wish I had given you more time. Please join me in thanking the panel. And by the way, I'm very relieved that the NMB's workload has been relieved by your efforts. Could I ask the next panel to come up seamlessly, please?